Welcome to worship at First Baptist Church of Madison, Wisconsin. Whether you are joining us live here through Zoom or you are joining us and worshiping along with us on Facebook, we welcome you. We are so glad that you are here on this first Sunday in Lent. Lent, of course, is a season of renewal, so it is perhaps fitting that we are trying something a little different and a little new. We are joining you, as you can see, from the sanctuary. We are doing that as safely as we can, and we will continue to stream our worship from here, or parts of our service from here, as long as we are able to do so safely, as long as conditions allow. As you saw already, Ted is rejoining us on the organ, and we are so grateful to him for doing that. But I also want to say a personal word of thanks to Matt, who is here, who will be leading in songs along with Ted. And I want to say thank you, of course, to Gil, our Zoom master, and to John, who is manning, so to speak, the cameras and the soundboard. So as we enter worship, again, welcome. We will now sing our opening hymn, In the Midst of New Dimensions.
In the midst of new dimensions, in the face of changing ways, who will lead the pilgrim people wandering in their separate ways? God of rainbow, fiery pillar, leading where the eagles soar, we, your people, are the journey, now and evermore. Through the flood of starving people, warring factions and despair, who will lift the olive branches, who will light the flame of care? God of rainbows, fiery pillar, leading where the eagles soar, we, your people, are the journey, now and evermore. Should the threat of dire predictions cause us to withdraw in pain, may your blazing phoenix spirit resurrect the church again. God of rainbow, fiery pillar, leading where the eagles soar, we, your people, are the journey, now and ever, now and evermore.
Please join me in our call to worship and invocation. I will read the light font, and I will ask you to respond with the letters in bold. Come, all you people, come and worship.
God has made a covenant with us.
Come, all creatures of the earth, come and worship.
God has made a covenant with all creatures.
Remember the covenant and be thankful.
Remember the covenant and be renewed.
Let us pray. God of the covenant, you are ever faithful. Your love never ends. Teach us your ways and guide us in your paths of love and justice so that we may be your partners in caring for all of creation. Amen. We enter now into a time of prayer. This is your opportunity to submit your prayer requests in the chat box. As we prepare, we will hear our prayer song from Kelsey.
Thy peace. Heal them, O Lord. Heal them, O Lord. Incline thy ear to us and grant us the
Please join me in prayer. God of love, hear the cry of those who yearn for love, fractured families, broken homes, neglected, unwanted, alone. God of love, hear our prayer. God of justice, hear the cry of those who yearn for justice, persecuted and oppressed, exploited, ill-treated, and broken. God of justice, hear our prayer. God of peace, hear the cry of those who yearn for peace in battle zones and broken states, frightened, fearful, anxious. God of peace, hear our prayer. God of healing, hear the cry of those who yearn for healing, physical and spiritual, hurting, weakened, depressed. God of healing, hear our prayer. God of mercy, hear the cry of those who yearn for mercy, convicted, in need of your grace, contrite, humble, bowed down. God of mercy, hear our prayer. We pray especially now for those requests that have been named here in this virtual space. We pray for the people of Texas who are without water and had been without electricity and are suffering the effects of the cold on their houses and on their lives. We pray for Jan, who is in that situation right now in need of proper plumbing repairs. We give thanks for the beautiful music. We give thanks for being able to be in this sanctuary. We give thanks for all of those involved and helping out this morning. God, help us to remember those who have passed, that they are still with us, part of the cloud of witnesses. We also pray especially this week for the Dewey family. God, in your mercy, hear our prayers. God of constancy, we give thanks for your covenant with us, shown forth in the rainbow of hope. Give us space to reflect, time to learn, and confidence to work for a more just, more fair time when the whole world can unite within your love, now and forever. Amen.
Good morning. The scripture reading this morning is taken from Genesis chapter 9, verses 8 through 17. Hear now the word of the Lord. Then God said to Noah and to his sons with him, "As for me, I am establishing my covenant with you and your descendants after you, and with every living creature that is with you, the birds, the domestic animals, and every animal of the earth with you, as many as came out of the ark. I establish my covenant with you that never again shall all flesh be cut off by the waters of a flood, and never again shall there be a flood to destroy the earth." God said, "This is the sign of the covenant that I make between me and you and every living creature that is with you for all future generations. I have set my bow in the clouds, and it shall be a sign of the covenant between me and the earth. When I bring clouds over the earth, and the bow is seen in the clouds, I will remember my covenant that is between me and you and every living creature of all flesh, and the waters shall never again become a flood to destroy all flesh. When the bow is in the clouds, I will see it and remember the everlasting covenant between God and every living creature of all flesh that is on the earth." God said to Noah, "This is the sign of the covenant that I have established between me and all flesh it is on the earth." May God bless the reading and our understanding of his word.
God of the sparrow, God of the whale, God of the swirling stars, how does the creature say, "Ah"? How does the creature say, "Praise"? God of the rainbow, God of the cross, God of the empty grave, how does the creature say, "Grace"? How does the creature say, "Thanks"? God of the hungry, God of the sick, God of the indigo, how does the creature say, "Care"? How does the creature say, "Life"? God of the neighbor, God of the foe, God of the pruning hook, how does the creature say, "Love"? How does the creature say, "Peace"?
Please join me in prayer. God, we come to you, trusting in your mercy and love, longing to understand your word more fully. We come at the beginning of our Lenten journey to be guided in your ways of love and justice, to experience renewal. Lead us, O God, to do what is just, and teach us to follow the humble way of Christ, your beloved. Amen. So I want to read you just a few words, a couple of excerpts from an ancient Mesopotamian myth. It goes like this. I built the hulls of the ark 175 feet high and the decks 175 feet wide. I constructed a top deck and six lower decks. I used 9 bulkheads to separate the hull into compartments. Then I caulked the ark with bitumen and asphalt thinned with oil. So the ark was completed in 7 days. I boarded my household, my animals, wild beasts, and craftspeople. At dawn, the horizons turned black with clouds. Adad, divine patron of thunder, roared. Shalat and Hanish, the divine messengers, flew before the wind. Nergal, divine patron of the dead, unlocked the fountain of the deep. Ninurta, son of Enlil, opened the dikes. The divine assembly strafed the earth with lightning. Adad turned the day into night, and the land was smashed like a pot. One person could not see the other. For 6 days and 7 nights, the winds blew. On the 7th day, the storm subsided, and the sea grew quiet. I felt the stillness. All humanity had become clay. I opened the hatch. Sunlight fell on my face. I bowed my face to the deck and wept. The ark ran aground on Mount Nasir. It remained grounded for 6 days. That is an excerpt from the Epic of Gilgamesh. And I'm sure parts of that sounded very familiar to you. It should have reminded you of some of the details in the Noah flood story. Even though the Epic of Gilgamesh is much older, great flood myths, sometimes we also call them deluge myths, they're very common. They appear throughout history in almost every culture, and oftentimes they are very, very, very old. They often also invoke creation myths from those same cultures. They tie the primeval waters that spawned life in the very beginning with the floodwaters that are sent to cleanse the earth in preparation for a rebirth and a renewal. A myth is defined as a traditional story, especially one concerning the early history of a people or explaining some natural or social phenomenon. And typically, they involve supernatural beings or events. And the book of Genesis is full of myths, a collection of writings by ancient people trying to make sense of their world. And sometimes, there are even multiple and contradictory versions. Two accounts of the same event. We see that, for example, with the creation story in Genesis early on. And we see that with two versions of the Noah story. That's right, I said two versions of the Noah story. Biblical scholars, when they take a look at this myth, they notice that there are some inconsistencies in the details within the great flood story found in Genesis. And they have argued that these differences suggest that the Noah story is actually two accounts that are artfully woven together into one. Let me give you some examples. In one of these accounts, the great flood lasts 40 days and 40 nights. And it's caused by heavy rainfall. I think that from the songs that we learn as kids, those are the details that we remember from the story. In this version, 7 pairs of each species of animal, clean animals, are taken onto the ark, and another pair of unclean animals. In this second version that is intertwined, you see different details. In this one, the flood lasts an entire year, and the story is chronicled. It gives stages. In this month, this happened. In that month, that happened. And the scripture tells us all the fountains of the great deep burst forth. So the flood didn't necessarily come from a heavy rainfall, but came from within the earth. In this version, and I think this is the one that we know, this is the one where one pair of clean and one pair of unclean animals of each species board the ark, two by two. We often don't notice the discrepancies in the details in the story because the two counts are told concurrently instead of consecutively. They're woven together into one story told at the same time, going back and forth between the details of the two accounts, rather than being told separately, end to end, like you find with the creation stories early on in Genesis. And I think this is really significant. We should pay attention to this. Why would there be different accounts of the same story? I think the fact that our scriptures contain multiple versions of certain myths, like the creation story and Noah's story, provides space for multiple interpretations of an event. And that gives us permission to disagree about what these stories symbolize, or what lessons we can learn from these stories. For centuries, Christians have interpreted the great flood story in Genesis this way. A vengeful God precipitates a mass casualty event, ending nearly all human and animal life as punishment for humanity's sin. A vengeful, angry God. And yet, Christian doctrine has traditionally held that God is only good. It is humans that are a combination of good and evil. God isn't evil. So that leaves us with this troubling question: how could a loving God be responsible for such evil? What if that's the wrong question? Instead of placing the blame for the flood entirely on God, what if we focused our gaze inward? When bad things happen, it is easier for us to blame someone else. It's easier for us to blame God than it is for us to consider how our own actions have precipitated something, to hold ourselves accountable for our behavior. Maybe that's what's going on here. Old Testament scholar Dr. W. Sibley Towner writes that the flood is a destiny that the human community unleashed on itself. The story of the flood is normative only in the sense that it says that our actions bring consequences. It is not intended to teach that all floods and natural disasters are punishments for human sin. According to scholars, myths commonly deal with these existential questions of life and death in particular. They mostly deal with what they call biological life crises, and those include cataclysmic events like floods. Myths often relate to these drastic changes that occur in our climate and our ecology, and they always involve the restructuring of a social relationship or of social relationships. So what if this great flood myth in Genesis isn't a story of divine punishment at all, but rather a warning about the natural consequences of humanity's careless behavior? An ancient people gave us a story about a universal catastrophe. Perhaps they did so because they were aware of the precariousness of existence, suggests Dr. Towner. So interpreted in this different way, today's scripture reading takes on a little bit of a different meaning. At least it does for me. the covenant that God enters into with Noah, his descendants, and all living creatures is not a promise to never again extinguish all life as a punishment for human sin. Rather, God's covenant represents a renewal of a relationship between the Creator and creation. God's covenant is a reminder that we, as humans, are created in the divine image. We were set apart. In Genesis, we learned this. We are set apart as God's representatives on earth. We are created as the caretakers of all other living things, created with purpose. But a covenant is not a one-way commitment. Covenantal relationships require mutuality. They require commitments from all parties involved. God's covenant with Noah and us, Noah's descendants, requires us to recommit to our roles as caretakers of creation. This week, we observe the beginning of the liturgical season of Lent. And oftentimes, we think of Lent as a season of reflection, of repentance, and of renewal. The 40 days of Lent represent the 40 days Jesus spent in the wilderness, enduring the testing of his character and preparing for the beginning of his earthly ministry. So what if we took advantage of this season of Lent to do the same, to reflect on what our earthly ministry should look like? What if we did some soul searching? And what if we reflected on the impacts that our words and our actions have on others? Would we discover that our own behaviors have done harm? Would we find things for which we need to repent? And what would repentance look like? How can we work toward renewal, the repairing of all of our relationships with God, with our fellow human beings, with the earth and all created things? I think today's lesson invites us to ask if we have come full circle. Are we once again faced with the precariousness of our existence because of our neglect of the planet and of our environment? As raging wildfires and massive mudslides and deadly Arctic temperatures threaten our lives, what will we do? Will we blame God? Or will we hold ourselves accountable, accept that our actions have consequences and create change? This is a time of reflection, repentance, and renewal. God has made a promise to all of creation and given a visible sign as a reminder, the rainbow. The rainbow, a symbol of life and hope. And now, the tables have turned. It's our turn to answer. God of the rainbow calls us to do the same, to commit to our part of the covenant. Amen.
We come now to the time of our offering, when we return to God a portion of the gifts that we have received from God. These gifts are used to sustain both the ministry of this church and the broader Christian ministry around the world. You may make your contribution by using the donate page on the church website, by using the Give Plus app on your smartphone, or by mailing a check to the church. Our offertory music is Trust and Obey. It will be sung by Jenny.
Please join me in the offertory prayer. Heavenly Parent, provide us with what we need each day. Help us to live our lives with open hearts and a spirit of thankfulness. May these gifts strengthen our church and its mission to help and encourage other people to experience love and joyful living. Thank you for sending Jesus to show us the way. Amen.
I have a few announcements to highlight. First of all, have you played bingo recently? We are having a First Baptist virtual bingo party this coming Saturday, February 27th at 4 p.m. The information on how to register for the party and to make bingo cards is in the bulletin. Are you curious about what is happening with the Catalyst Project? Susan Donahoe and Anna will bring us up to date on this exciting ministry that they have been doing. Save the date for that. It is March the 21st at 2 p.m. on Zoom. There's more information on this in the bulletin. Easter is coming, with it the chance to buy Easter lilies. Information how to do that is in the bulletin. To pay for the Easter lilies, you can either mail a check to the church or make your payment on the church website. Jenny, if you put up the next slide, I will show you how to make your payment on the church website. Here you see a screenshot of the donate page on the church website. And there's a line down here at the bottom that says other gifts. And all you need to do is put in the amount that you're paying in this first box. And then in the box next to it, you type in lilies. And then the rest of it, you just pay like you would for any other donation that you're making to the church. And so when this then comes back to the church office, they will know that you have made the payment and that it is for Easter lilies. Our closing song is You Are. We will be led by Kelsey.
You are holy, you are faithful. You are Savior, you are fair. You are all I ever need, Lord, you are. You are every question's answer. You are every reason why. You are moving, you are still, Lord, you are. You are Lord on high. You are the way, the truth, the lie. You are the Word made flesh. You are the bright morning star. On earth, you are Alpha and Omega. You are comfort, you are refuge, you are love personified, you are kindness and compassion. You are Lord on high, you are the way, the truth, the life. You flesh, you are the bright morning star. You are my God and my King. You are the words that I sing. You are the reason I make this offering. You are my God and my King. You are the words that I sing. You are the reason I make this offering.
After the benediction, you are invited to stick behind and join us for a time of fellowship in small groups. And so please stay around. All are welcome to join us for the discussions. Hear now this benediction. Walk in the paths of steadfast love and faithfulness. Dwell under the rainbow of God's love. Proclaim the good news of God, for God's realm is near. Go in peace.